Our final speaker is Alex LaRotta. He's a first-generation Colombian Texan with a strong respect and affection for both of his cultural heritages. He graduated from Stephen Austin State University in 2006 with a BA in political science, and following that moved to Bogota, Colombia for 6 months, where he lived with his lovable, although often fussy, grandmother, tutored English and perfected his Spanish. Upon his return, he received a wonderful job, and which I would agree with, which he still maintains today. He's a sound engineer for Austin City Limits. He's enrolled in Texas State University last year, where he is happily pursuing his master's with a focus on music history in the American Southwest. Alex LaRotta.
Thank you. All righty. Well, it's a pleasure to be here. This is both my first time to attend and first time to present, obviously, so bear with me if I repeat myself. What I'm going to be doing today is presenting the culmination of my research project last semester, my first semester of graduate school, as mentioned. I know this is called Tex-Mex Music Pioneers, Recording Pioneers in the pamphlet. However, I changed it to something a little bit more appropriate, to Musica Tejana Recording Pioneers. And I'll tell you why. It's a little bit more appropriate because Musica Tejana sort of incorporates a little bit more what I'm trying to go after here, a sort of narrative history of the post-World War II industrial boom, record boom from the Mexican-American community in Texas into about the mid-1980s, so about a 40-plus year time frame. And this is sort of a time frame I dub as an independent era, i.e., independent of the recording establishment of New York, Chicago, and later Los Angeles. However, bookended of these two eras, of course, is the influence of New York and Chicago when recording firms from some of these bigger companies would come into Texas and set up mobile recording units and record and distribute Musica Tejana. Before I go into that a little bit further, though, Musica Tejana is not really a genre. It's not one sound. However, it encompasses many different sounds. So it's sort of an umbrella term, if you will. It's corridos, it's rancheras, polkas, some of what Mr. McClung was showing us earlier. It's very diverse, and so there's very very dynamic sounds. Tejano, as it's popularly known, is sort of the modern interpretation, the modern sound of Musica Tejana. So in the 1920s and 1930s, as these recording firms were coming into Dallas and San Antonio, Texas obviously was a very popular destination for some of these record companies looking to explore vernacular styles in Texas, being at the sort of the cusp of the cultural crossroads of the American Southwest, the Deep South, Greater Mexico. There's so many different ethnic styles and musical styles that Texas is naturally a first place to go. San Antonio, we all know about the Robert Johnson sessions in San Antonio. So obviously a lot of blues sessions there, but a lot of Musica Tejana as well. Some of the first stars were like Lydia Mendoza with her big hit Mal Hombre. This is sort of the beginning of Musica Tejana. Now, so the blueprint, what I identify as sort of the blueprint sound of Musica Tejana, is conjunto. That literally translates to group, like group music. Conjunto, if we were to understand it in its most like prime state, is basically a two-tiered instrumentation. You have your accordion, driven from German and Czech influences in Texas in the mid-19th century, and you have your bajo sexto, which you heard also in some of these recordings from Mr. McClung, which is a 12-string bass instrument, the accompaniment. So that's conjunto, that's the blueprint of Musica Tejana, and it sort of stems from there. Conjunto, if I was to dig back just a little bit further, stems from northern Mexico. It's sort of the break-off of Norteño music, when both are still sort of in competition today. Now, as a result of, the short of a shellac during World War II, the Musicians Union strike in 1942. Vernacular music fell out of favor of some of these bigger labels, from Columbia to RCA Victor to the boutique labels of Bluebonnet. That all changes in 1945. What kicks off what I identify as the beginning of the independent era in Texas with a recording by a man by the name of Armando Marroquín. This is Armando at his Ampex 300 tape machine in Alice, Texas. What I have here is what is historically now recognized as the first recording by a Mexican-American This is by his wife and his sister-in-law, Carmen and Laura. The name of this track is Se Me Fue Mi Amor, which translates to My Love Has Left. I don't hear it, so that means it's not there. It's volume's up. Well, what you should have been hearing is the first conjunto. At any rate, it was recording in 1945 in Alice, Texas. Alice, Texas today is a small town. It's nestled in between San Antonio and the Rio Grande Valley. The Rio Grande Valley is sort of the hub of this Mexican-American recording unit, sort of the hotbed of Musica Tejana in Texas. It's a little town, a little speck of a town. Now, for some of the more like gear involved mechanics here, or studio engineers, if you're familiar with the Ampex 300, you know this came out in 1949. This is a picture of him with 1950, so he must have gotten it shortly after it came out, shortly after it was commercially available.
That's the MagnaCord PT6.
Ah.
That's not an Ampex. Made in Chicago.
Ah.
It's a MagnaCord PT6. Chief engineer, John Boyer.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I appreciate that clarification. I was told through an oral interview with Armando Marroquín that he did, in fact, use one.
Probably did.
Yeah. So I'm sorry, say the name of it again?
Probably did use.
Now, that's a cutting lathe.
That's a Presto turntable.
Right. Which is likely a Recco cut. So that's what I'm assuming. I know that some Texas recording engineers use RecoCut. Maybe those who are a little bit more adept, like the gentleman here in the front, if you could identify that lathe, I believe it's a RecoCut. What he would have been using if he's recording straight to acetate before the tape machine. Let me see. No, that's part of the picture there. Yeah, I apologize, a little technical thing here. Yeah, gotcha. Okay. At any rate. So this is Armando Marroquín in Alice, Texas. Armando goes on to become one of the first recording pioneers for the Mexican-American community in Texas. Armando, in 1948, starts Ideal Records, which actually, this is really neat. If you look at Bill's sheet, you can see that out of all these Texas 78s, they put out it's one of the most prolific record labels in Texas. So along with Ideal Records, there's Arnaldo Ramirez of Falcon Records. Also in 1948, he's incorporated his Felton record. For about four decades, they put out 78s, 45s, LPs. Arnaldo Ramirez was located in Mission, Texas. And these two guys were sort of the kingpins of South Texas. They put out a litany of records by a lot of local talent. So this is sort of, I kind of want to demonstrate sort of this transition from these external forces or these external recording units to local entrepreneurs, local sounds. And with that became sort of a self-sustained industry. So they would be recording here before the advent of pressing plants. They would be sending obviously the master recordings out to maybe Los Angeles or New York. In 1947 becomes a Texas's first pressing plant, San Antonio. And so these are some of the first 78 RPM pressings in South Texas. We have Baltimore Huerta, who we had mentioned earlier, is Freddie Fender. And Ideal Records, which I believe this is the very first pressing by Beto Villa, Rosita. Just to sort of demonstrate what I had mentioned earlier, the Rio Grande Valley, Alice sort of nestled in between there, Corpus Christi being a major hub of recording activity by the mid-20th century, and there San Antonio. Now, I want to demonstrate this because what's interesting here is by the mid-20th century, so as we get into about the 1950s, urbanization, industrialization brings some of the Mexican-American community in South Texas into San Antonio. San Antonio then becomes sort of, I guess, as Nashville became to country music, Musica Tejana became to San Antonio. A litany of new labels, new entrepreneurs, new producers, and self-made distributors, all within the Mexican-American community. But this is a statewide industry, which is really the interesting thing about this. Once we have these pressing plants in San Antonio, and particularly one created by Bob Tanner in 1947, this means no more reliance on on these pressing plants on the East and West Coast. Beto Villa became a popular saxophonist, but he also sort of modernized the conjunto sound that I had mentioned earlier. This becomes sort of a big combo sound, so a very urban, dressed up and tail sort of sound of the elder conjunto sound. Finebilt, this is just a trade ed that I had found from earlier. This is actually from a Billboard trade ad. This is what Armando Marroquín, according to an oral interview, when him and his partner Baco Betancourt, when they were first creating records, were pressing with Finebilt record presses. I'm trying to figure out why it's so sketchy there. Sorry about that. It's kind of weird.
Is your plug shoved in all the way?
Yeah, it looks like it is. It's kind of very sensitive there. At any rate, this is what some of these early entrepreneurs would have been using, some sort of catalog order pressing plant. Now, later into the 1950s, into the 1960s, you have sort of a culmination of like a hodgepodge sound, the West Side sound of San Antonio. This would have been a mix of R&B, of polka, of soul, rock and roll. So new labels start to develop. This is sort of your post-war sound. And so Royal Jesters were sort of on the cutting edge of that San Antonio West Side sound. Manny Guerra becomes one of the entrepreneurs that puts out some records by the Royal Jesters. Here's another trade ad. By El Zarape Records from Dallas, Texas. So into the 1960s and 1970s, as all these new record labels are coming about, El Zarape Records becomes sort of the zenith point. Oh, that's a little obnoxious. Sorry about that. I don't know why that is. Of this new Chicano sound, this Musica Tejana. They're based out of Dallas, Texas. So they were moving. Oh, thanks. Yeah, it seems like it's connected there. The proprietor of this record label is a man by the name of Johnny Gonzalez, who was distributing with CBS International at the time, but he was also distributing independently before he linked up with CBS International. He sort of coined this term, La Onda Chicana. This is one of the first trade ads that uses that term in 1972. And what I wanted to demonstrate after is sort of, so as these little independent labels are flying high and they're doing well, bookended by the end of the 1970s, the core sort of instrumentation had changed. And a lot of the major labels that were in Texas before came back by the 1980s and were sort of trying to cross over the Tejano sound into a bigger international market. Oh, thanks. But because of piracy, because of bootlegging, a lot of these independents were hit very hard, and it was sort of taken over by new bigger labels, bigger production budgets. Here's a picture of Selena. That's sort of the zenith, the culmination of música Tejana as it sort of crosses over into this new Tejana genre. But yeah, that's so by the mid-1980s, that's sort of the end of the independent era. And that wraps up my presentation. Thank you.
It's about the Norman Petty Studio.
You know, I didn't find anything from Norman Petty. I know that, and I'm familiar with that studio there, and I didn't find anything from Clovis. I know that some of these Tejano stars had recorded in Phoenix, and there's some activity in New Mexico with, there was a gentleman there by the name of Al Hurricane and Tini Marie, and they were in Albuquerque, I believe. But no, as far as the Norman Petty studios, no, I did not. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the new reissue of the Robert Johnson recordings, they have a bonus CD. It's called On the Same Days or something like that. Or, and there are the other sessions that took place with the ARC crews on those days.
Right.
Some of that music is sung in Spanish and seems to be, you know, very, very similar to the early music that you cited.
Absolutely. No, and maybe I didn't clarify that. No, in fact, that's when the first recordings were during those sessions. 1934 is the earliest recording I know of. Sort of the point of what I was trying to drive through my presentation is just the independent eras when local entrepreneurs or local recorders, excuse me, recordists were recording.
So